morning. I'm not too big. I'm like something taller than me. Welcome to St. Paul's Kanata. Thank you for joining us for our Sunday morning worship. Our God Squad Sunday School program is being offered today, so if you would like your kids to participate, please bring them to the downstairs classroom as the service begins. They will join us again in time for communion. A reminder that we are now offering coffee hour between the services each Sunday, so if you would like some coffee and conversation. I'm not loud enough?
You're not loud enough.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I know your wife will never tell you that you need to be louder, but I'm going to tell you got to be louder.
I never think to check that.
That's why they pay me to do coffee.
Can you hear me now? Do I need to start all over again,
no,
or do you think?
No, I think we caught the first bit.
Okay.
And I think the people watching at home won't send their kids in this late.
So. Okay. I'll just start the coffee again. A reminder that we now offer coffee hour between the services each Sunday. So if you would like some coffee and conversation, please make your way to Rudder Hall after this today's service. And that is out into the narthex and to the left.
I'll also add, we have air conditioning in the hall.
Oh.
So that is an added plus.
Do we have a fan blowing from there into here?
Well, actually,
I'm going to have my children with big palm leaves waving.
Well, it's not too bad today. Thank God it's cooled off a bit because we had some heat this week, didn't we? Anyway, please stand now for the opening hymn. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen. May his grace and his peace be with you. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son, Jesus Christ, is the way, the truth, and the life. Give us grace to love one another and walk in the way of his commandments, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please have a seat as we hear our first reading.
Excuse me. The first reading is taken from the Revelation to John, chapter 21, beginning at the first verse. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Excuse me. And the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is coming to among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water as a gift from the spring of life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm number 148 on found in Book of Alternative Services, page 907. Read it responsively on the half verse. Hallelujah, praise the Lord from the heavens.
Praise him in the heights.
Praise him, all you angels of his.
Praise him, all his hosts.
Praise him, sun and moon.
Praise him, all you shining stars.
Praise him, heaven of heavens.
And you waters above the heavens.
Let them praise the name of the Lord.
For he commanded and they were created.
He made them stand fast forever and ever. Praise the Lord from the earth.
You see monsters and all beasts.
Fire and hail, snow and fog.
Tempestuous wind doing his will.
Mountains and all hills.
Fruit trees and all spheres.
Wild beasts and all cattle.
Creeping things and winged birds.
Kings of the earth and all peoples.
Princes and all rulers of the world.
Young men and maidens.
Old and young together.
Let them praise the name of the Lord.
For his name only is exalted, his splendor is over earth and heaven.
He has raised up the strength of his people and prays for all his loyal servants.
The children of Israel, a people who are near him.
I invite you now to stand for the reading of the gospel. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. When Judas had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and will glorify him at once. Little children, I'm with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." This is the gospel of Christ. As we remain standing, let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be now and always acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. One of my favorite good time movies to watch is a movie by the Coen brothers called O Brother, Where Art Thou? Some of you may have seen that. It's kind of a silly movie from the 30s about a person who goes on a quest to try and restore his marriage. But one of the things that stands out for me in that movie is a song called The Big Rock Candy Mountain. And some of you may remember that. Burl Ives, I think, did the most famous version of it. But I liked it very much. And one of the things that I enjoyed was this part of the lyrics. "In the Big Rock Candy Mountains, all the cops have wooden legs, and the bulldogs all have rubber teeth, and the hens lay soft boiled eggs. The farmer's trees are full of fruit, and the barns are full of hay. Well, I'm bound to go where there ain't no snow, where the rain don't fall and the wind don't blow in the Big Rock Candy Mountains." It's a cute, funny little song because it's really what a person in the 30s who's maybe struggling with getting on the rails and finding work might imagine heaven is like, a place where the lake is full of whiskey and a place where he says cigarettes grow on trees and where the police can't chase you because their legs are all wooden, and when a dog bites you, it won't hurt you because his teeth are made out of rubber. These are all a great, silly little song, but I mention that to you today not because I want you to listen to the song, although it's worth doing, but because it is, I think, an illustration of the way that we often tend to think about heaven. Preachers, I think, are often afraid to talk about the heavenly vision because we tend to think of heaven in ways that are like this song.
limited by our own imagination. If you're a person in the 30s, you can well imagine how wonderful it would be that when I got onto the rails, a policeman couldn't shoo me off because he couldn't catch me and his legs were wooden. Or when I tried to steal a pie from somebody's windowsill, the dog couldn't hurt me because its teeth were made of rubber. You can imagine a modern preacher staying away from heavenly visions because what do you think of? Oh, heaven's great because there's free Wi-Fi and the Senators make the playoffs every year. It's kind of silly, that kind of vision, because you know that it's not terribly inspiring because it's limited by what the preacher can imagine. And yet, I want to speak to you today about the heavenly vision because, first of all, it shows up in our readings today. It's an important reading that is often, from the book of Revelation, often read at funerals, but also because it forms a really core part of our Christian faith. When we say the creed, at the end of the creed, we will say, I believe in the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. This is not some add-on that we as Christians can sort of hold on to or not hold on to depending on how we feel. It is an essential and core part of what we as Christians believe. And so we need to have some ways of speaking and thinking about the heavenly vision that isn't silly and that isn't limited by our imagination. So I want to speak to you today about this first reading from Revelation 21 and really focus on three things. First of all, the heavenly vision is a vision that is a totally transforming and all-encompassing vision. Secondly, it's a vision that is in continuity with the world that we live in and that we can experience today. And thirdly, that we as Christians are charged as a church and as individuals to be signs of the heavenly vision, living signs that point people to the reality of what is to come. And I'll unpack that a little bit, what I mean by each of these as we go on. So what do I mean by saying it's a total vision? When you listen to this passage, when we hear the very first words, what do we hear? We hear John saying, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. Now, we might very well sort of say, well, heaven is gone and earth is gone and something new happens, as if they're two individual things, but maybe there's other things out there. There's the ocean, there's the lava under the earth. When we say heaven and earth, in fact, the scriptures, when they say heaven and earth together, they're actually talking about all of creation. Think about when you might say in modern language, although I guess maybe you don't hear it as often anymore, but you say, well, what do you want me to take with me? You can say, well, I want you to take the whole kit and caboodle. Well, what does that mean? Well, take the kit and also take the caboodle, but leave everything else. No, it means the whole kit and caboodle means I want you to take everything. When we say in the creed, I believe in God, the creator of heaven and earth, we're not saying two things God created and nothing else. When the Nicene Creed fills it out a little bit more, and we only usually say this on festival days, we say the maker of heaven and earth, of all things seen and unseen. This is a speaking about everything will be changed. And the idea that everything will be changed, first of all, is to say the sea will be no more. It doesn't mean that there's no surfing in the new heaven and new earth. The sea for the Jewish people, which were generally a land-based people, farmers, people who did things in Israel and were not known as seafaring people, the sea was a symbol of chaos. Think about the first chapter of Genesis, that the Spirit hovered over the waters, but the earth was formless and void. This idea of a crashing sea that is threatening and full of disorder and chaos is something that God says in this revelation will be gone. It doesn't mean there's no water. It means instead to say that chaos and uncertainty will be gone. What a radical transformation. And then he goes on to say, God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning, crying, pain will be no more. The first things have passed away. To see a world in which death and mourning and crying have passed away is a profound change. Think about even how we age. Our aging process is partly because over time, parts of us that used to be effective at getting rid of genetic mutations and other things starts winding down, and we find ourselves getting aches and pains over life that we didn't have when we were younger. Death is a part of life, and we all know it. When we talk about the heavenly vision, we're talking about God noticing and recognizing that in this life, not only do we face tremendous challenges from the big things, but every aspect of life has challenges because there is a decay written into the created order that God says he will reverse. And when we look at this vision, he says, I want you to see this in detail, not by looking at the big picture. But he narrows it down to a particular city and says, I want to show you what this transformation looks like for a city. One of the things that's interesting here is that when he looks up and he sees something coming from heaven, what does he see? He sees the city of Jerusalem. And we are told it is a new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. What's notable about this is that if you read through the scriptures, you know that in fact the city, and particularly the city of Jerusalem, is an unlikely symbol for heaven. If you read the first chapters of Genesis, what you'll find is the very first city is founded by a pretty notorious character. After Cain kills his brother Abel, he goes off and he founds a city called Enoch, as if he's fleeing from God's presence and wants to protect himself from God. The next city we encounter in Genesis is the city of Babel, famously trying to build a tower up to heaven, not to bring heaven down to earth, but the earth up to heaven, as if the human beings can conquer the heavens. Again and again, Jerusalem is a place that attacks the prophets. Jesus, when he comes to Jerusalem just before his crucifixion, weeps. And he says, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to you. How I long to gather you together as a hen gathers chicks under her wings, but you would not have it." Jesus himself comes to Jerusalem and says, "You are a picture of a city in rebellion against God." And then, of course, what happens? They actually crucify Jesus. When the book of Revelation is written, it's probably at the beginning of the second century. And when it's written, what we also know is that the writer is aware that Jerusalem doesn't even exist anymore. About 30 years after Jesus' death and resurrection, the Roman armies come, destroy Jerusalem, wipe out the temple, and they replace it with a pagan city called Jupiter Capitolina. And they start worshiping Jupiter, the main god of the Romans, and it ceases to be a Jewish city at all. And so here, when there is a vision, what are we given? We are given a vision of a transformation. A city you have come to know as a city in rebellion against God is radically transformed into a city that is adorned like a bride. And what do we say when we see the happy couple standing before us in a wedding? It's because they've spent probably a lot of money and a lot of time making themselves look as good as possible. Not the thing you do when you just roll out of bed in the morning. You look at a bride adorned for her wedding day, you look at someone who is at their very best. And what we find here is a city transformed and changed. The hope we have is the hope that we will one day have this very place. A place in which what is evil, what is corrupt, and what is decaying in this life will be changed into something that we find joy in. And God says, this is something to hold on to when we walk through this veil of tears. For we know that life is often a veil of tears, but we know that God is one capable of transforming it. We look to the heavenly vision because we as Christians believe there is hope for a troubled world. Now, I mentioned that the vision is a fully transforming one, but I also want to stress the continuity of this vision. By continuity, I mean that what we are seeing in this is not something completely different than our daily experience today. What we are instead seeing is something that is continuous with the experience we have. Again, note what it is that John sees when he sees this revelation. He says, "I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband." You notice what he doesn't see? He doesn't see, "I see a new city, which I can't name because I've never seen it before." When he looks up and he sees coming down from heaven a city, he recognizes it for what it is. It is the holy city, which is Jerusalem. It is recognizable as the city that he knows and that he lives in. It's an important thing for us to hold on to because, of course, what we might want to think is that when God transforms the world, he's just going to wipe it out and start fresh. Think about what visions we tend to have of God and our peace with God. Most of the time, I think when we feel like we're most at peace with God, we tend to think somewhere in nature, right? Maybe you're out canoeing in Algonquin Park. Maybe you're tending your garden. Or maybe now, as your mind wanders, as I blather on, you're listening to the birds tweet outside. That's where God is making me feel like he's present. So often, though, when you go to the city, what do you see? I grew up in Vancouver, and one of the sad things I would see in the city is that I would go out maybe with my friends or my parents to Gastown downtown. You go to a very nice restaurant, and you'd go, and you'd smell the wonderful sea air. And you'd go just one block later, and the worst of human misery would be on display. Vancouver has a really sharp division where things are very nice downtown, and you go down two blocks and you find there that people are stumbling around in flip-flops and sweatpants, even in the midst of winter, because it is prevalence of drugs and of hard poverty. And you think, wow, this is a dark place in so many ways, and it's hard for me to feel that I'm close. When God chooses to bring a city down from heaven to earth, I think what he's doing is showing us that what we are to do in this life is not to dream when we can leave and go to heaven to some better place. Instead, what we dream of is that the glimpses we see of God here, we see glimpses of God at work in this world, that we can love the things of this world in the hope that one day the things of this world will be transformed, not replaced, but transformed. When we look at Vancouver, for example, me growing up, I don't look for the day when it will be gone and replaced. I look for the day instead where the city that I love and grew up in will have dignity given to its poor, in which the cramped quarters in which so many people live there will be spacious, in which we who walk by those who are hurting and ignore them, no longer ignore them, but instead extend love and sympathy. What we are to look for in this vision is not for this day when we will leave this earth. Instead, we look for the day when we see Kanata coming down from heaven to earth, and to ask how it is that we can look around our community and edge it towards the day, bring it a little bit closer to the day when it will become that bride adorned for her husband, and how it is that we can make our community and the people that live in it draw closer and closer to what they were meant to be. I think we are called to love this community so that when we go out to the farm boy, for example, probably not with a great sense of the heavenly vision before our eyes, nevertheless, what do we think? We are called to think that maybe by showing kindness to the person at the cash who makes a little mistake, maybe to compliment or to help a person who has a hard time getting something off the top shelf. Things as simple as that show a little bit of human dignity, a little bit of that divine spark in some small way we are edging the farm boy towards that day when farm boy will descend from the heaven to the earth. And of course, if you ever go to places like La Provence, you know that you don't have very far to go because their pastries are already extremely heavenly. You only need to edge them a little bit in the right direction. In all seriousness, what we are called to do is to passionately love this world in the knowledge that when we are doing that, we're making it just a little bit more like what it one day will be by the power and grace of our God. Here's the last thing. I mentioned to you that what we are called to do in this heavenly vision is to become people who reflect that heavenly vision to the world. It's an interesting little phrase here, but it's a really important one. It says, when John sees this city come down, he hears a voice, and that voice says, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. You know how John's gospel begins? John's gospel begins talking about the Word and how the Word was with God. But the Word becomes flesh and dwells among us. The very same word, dwell, is actually the word tabernacle. Jesus comes and pitches his tent amongst his people. And here we find that God is doing this in the end. He is bringing himself to live with all peoples. But what Jesus says when he says that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us is not that this is simply something we need to wait for. Instead, he says that when Jesus is near in our world today, the kingdom of God is near in our world today. When Jesus casts out a demon or heals somebody, he says, the kingdom of God is near. Why? Because you see Jesus acting on individual people, making a difference in the world, and you catch some glimpse of what the whole world will be like because of what Jesus does. But Jesus doesn't leave it there. In the end of John's gospel, he breathes on his disciples and says, receive the Holy Spirit. When Pentecost comes, we will celebrate in a few weeks' time when the Spirit is poured out on peoples from every corner of the globe who were there in Jerusalem, and the Spirit falls on them, and they go out into the world proclaiming the gospel. They become the body of Christ on earth. St. Paul often talks about how the church is the body of Christ. You and me are meant to be people who show Christ to this world. We are meant to be pieces of heaven in a world that is full of sorrows, that people look at us and they say, aha, I see from what I see in you. But the hope is we all have, the hope that the world be transformed. We pray the Lord's Prayer each week, and we pray it, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're not just looking for something in the future. We're asking that God will empower us to make His kingdom clear and present today. By loving your neighbor, by proclaiming God's name and singing our praises with hearty joy today, we are showing a little glimpse of heaven to the world. When a person walks through the doors of this church, they are meant to come and see a community that resembles the community that God will bring about in the last days. They are to come here and see, aha, I may realize that in this world people don't love each other, they don't forgive each other, they aren't kind with one another, they don't give to each other, but in this church I see them doing all of those things. And for that reason I believe that God is capable of bringing this thing about in the end. You are to be an inspiration. I am to be an inspiration. All of us are to be an inspiration that God is at work in this world. And because we see God at work in you and me, we believe that God will bring all things to its proper end. So what are we called to do in holding on this heavenly vision? To hold on hope that what is broken in this world today, God will transform. We are called to love this world today, knowing that the things that are good and holy in it will be wiped off and made clean, and that God will not wipe away the things we love, but instead they will last. And finally, we are to be people who show evidence that God is bringing this about by showing the world that God is at work in us, healing, bringing what is good and right. And for that reason, people are to look at us and say, aha, I know God has the power to make all things right, because I see all things right in this person. Let God, by His grace, transform this church and make us the city on the hill that God wants us to be. Let us pray. Lord God, thank you for this heavenly vision. Help us not to think it is a far off or a silly thing. Help us to remember that in speaking to us about a new Jerusalem that descends from the heavens, you are speaking to us about a very solid thing that you are sure to bring about. A total transformation of this world where every tear is wiped away. And yet, in the midst of that transformation, also is a world in which you preserve what is good and ensure that the good things we do in your name will last. Help us to be faithful witnesses to Christ, whoever we are and wherever we are. And help us, O Lord, as a church, to be a sign of the coming kingdom, a place where your name is known not only by what we say, but in the love we show for one another. This we ask in Christ's name. Amen. I'll ask you now to stand as we say together the creed. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite you now to sit or to kneel as we pray the prayers of the people.
In joy and hope, let us pray the source of all life, saying, hear us, Lord of glory. That our risen Savior may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection, let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That isolated and persecuted churches may find fresh strength in the Easter gospel, that those who suffer in every area of persecution may be relieved and protected, that those in positions of authority would work for their liberty. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That Christ would bless his bride, the church, wherever she gathers today. We pray for those congregations in our diocese and around the world which are named in our bulletin. We think especially of our sister churches throughout our community, St. Mina and St. Karis Coptic Church, Catch the Fire, The Bridge, and Trinity Presbyterian Church. That the Holy Spirit would unite us in faith as we serve our Lord together. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That God may grant us humility to be subject to one another in Christian love. That he would pour out his wisdom on Elizabeth, our Queen, Justin, our Prime Minister, Doug, our Premier, Shane, our Bishop, St. Paul's clergy team and staff, Stephen, Alana, Bill, Sally, Nash, David, Darlene, and their families, and on all ministry leaders. Remember, especially this morning, Cornerstone Newsletter, Allison Stoltz, tech team, Colin McKenzie, webmaster, Steve Seamus. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That God may bless the upcoming marriage of Bob McNichol and Jennifer Dunham. May their love for each other continue to grow. Hear us, Lord of glory.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That our church may be strengthened in its commitment to Christ and to advancing his work in the world. We might grow in number and maturity and trust God through our daily challenges. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That God may provide for those who lack food, work, or shelter, for those weighed down by addiction, anxiety, or isolation. They pray for particularly the people of Manitoba as they deal with widespread flooding. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That God may reveal the light of his presence to the sick, the weak, and the dying. Today we pray especially for those afflicted with the coronavirus, for those named in our bulletin, for those on our hearts, and for those grieving the dead. Remember especially this morning Viola Campbell, whose funeral was yesterday, for Robert Ferrier's funeral is on May 20th. We pray for Viola and Robert and their families, that they may find comfort in the midst of their anguish. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord.
That by God's power, war and famine may cease through all the earth. Today we think especially of Ukraine. Give comfort to those who suffer because of the violence. Give comfort to those who mourn their dead, and strength to neighboring countries to welcome the refugees. Convert the hearts of those who resort to arms and protect those who work to promote peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord of glory.
That God may send the fire of the Holy Spirit upon his people, empowering us as faithful witnesses of the resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord.
Accept, O Lord, our thanks and praise for all you've done for us. We thank you for the splendor of the whole creation, for the beauty of this world, for the wonder of life, and for the mystery of love. Above all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word and the example of his life, for steadfast obedience, by which he overcame temptation, for his dying, through which he overcame death, for his rising to life again, in which we are raised to life of your kingdom. Grant us the gift of your Spirit, that we know Christ and make him known, and through him and at all times and all places, we give thanks to you. Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us now confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As you're able, I invite you to stand. May the peace of our Lord be always with you. Please wish your neighbor a sign of God's peace.
We got kids coming? Well, let's do our prayer first, Colin, and then we'll have the kids come in for their talk. Gracious God, you show us your way and give us your divine life. May everything we do be directed by the knowledge of your truth. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Amen. Please be seated for a moment. Our young folks are going to come in and show us what they've been up to.
Everybody?
Hello.
We made it. So, good morning. Did we have lots of fun in Sunday school?
Yes.
Yes.
Good. I hope you were having as much fun up here. Now, last week was Good Shepherd Sunday, some of you may remember, but we thought it was such a good lesson that we decided to do it again for the kids this week. So, we learned about the Good Shepherd, right? What happened to that one sheep? Was it lost?
Yes.
Yes, that one sheep was lost. Was it scared?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, it was scared. And some of us, we talked about times that we got lost, right? Some of us talked about good times that we had with our families, right? Looking at tulips or eating ice cream. And then we did a craft. We made sheep. So everybody hold up your sheep. We may have quite a flock of sheep. And every sheep is different, right? Some sheep are on their hind legs. Some sheep are very, very woolly. We got a merino sheep. Different texture of wool, very desirable. We've got a sheep with a rainbow. We've got an avant-garde sheep. We've got all kinds of, some sheep are lying down, some sheep are walking, some sheep are standing still because they're all different. There's a sermon in that. Maybe for next year. All right, and we are looking forward to possibly working on a song to sing for you all at some point. So we're working hard on that. We've made a good flock of sheep, and we had a good time, right? Excellent. Excellent. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Please stand. Just a quick word. I'd like to go, if we could, just a quick run through on the musical setting for this so that we all know how the responses go. I know for a long time we weren't doing a musical response for this part of the service, so we're doing that now. So just if David, I'll do a run through in the first few, what are known the responses, and our choir will lead us. So just listen to the way the choir sings, and that's the way we'll be singing it throughout our Easter season.
Be with you,
and also with you.
Lift up your hearts, we lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord.
So we'll start from the top, if we could, then, David, and then we'll continue on with our Eucharistic prayer.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift
thanks to the Lord our God. Gracious God, Creator of heaven and earth, we give you thanks and praise for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb, who has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us eternal life. Therefore, joining our voices with the whole company of heaven, we sing a joyful hymn of praise to proclaim the glory of your name.
We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new. Bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
As our Savior taught us, let us pray. Lord, we died with you on the cross. We're buried in your tomb. Live in us that we may live in you. The gifts of God for the people of God. Be asking our musicians to come forward first by lining up in front of the altar. Once they've received, our sides persons will indicate the right time to come forward. A reminder that we are now offering the cup for those who wish to take it. You're under no obligation to do so, but if you would like to receive the cup, Bill will be standing in front of the pulpit, and you can go and receive the cup once you've received bread if you wish to do so.
Christ, the bread of heaven. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Body of Christ given for you. Body of Christ. Body of Christ.
Please stand. God of love, in this Eucharist we have heard your truth and shared in your life. May we always walk in your way. In the name of Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father and Son and Holy Spirit, be with you now and forevermore. Amen. Hallelujah. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.